Penguin Random House Audio presents A Practical Handbook for the Actor by Melissa Bruder, Lee Michael Cohn, Madeleine Olnek, Nathaniel Pollack, Robert Previto, and Scott Zigler. Read for you by Rose Byrne, with special appearances by Chris Bauer and Alison Wright, and additional narration by Max Meyers, with an introduction written and read by David Mamet.
This book is dedicated to W.H. Macy and David Mamet. Always tell the truth. It's the easiest thing to remember.
Introduction by David Mamet.
Most acting training is based on shame and guilt. If you've studied acting, you've been asked to do exercises you didn't understand, and when you did them as your teacher or judged badly, you submitted guiltily to the criticism. You've been asked to do exercises you did understand, but whose application to the craft of acting escaped you, and you were ashamed to ask that their usefulness be explained. As you did these exercises, it seemed that everyone around you understand their purpose but you. So guiltily, you learned to pretend. You learned to pretend to smell the coffee when doing sensory exercises. You learned to pretend that the mirror exercise was demanding and that doing it well would somehow make you more attuned on stage. You learned to pretend to hear the music with your toes and to use the space. As you went from one class to the next, from one teacher to the next, two things happened. Being human, your need to believe asserted itself. You were loath to believe that your teachers were frauds, and so you began to believe that you yourself were a fraud. This contempt for yourself became contempt for all those who did not share the particular bent of your school of training. While keeping up an outward show of perpetual study, you began to believe that no actual practicable technique of acting existed, and this was the only possible belief supported by the evidence. Now, how do I know these things about you? I know them because I suffered them myself. I suffer them as a longtime student of acting and as an actor. I suffer them secondhand as a teacher of acting, as a director, and as a playwright. I know that you're dedicated and eager, eager to learn, eager to believe, eager to find a way to bring that art which you feel in yourself to the stage. You're legitimately willing to sacrifice, and you think that the sacrifice required of you is subjugation to the will of a teacher. But a more exacting sacrifice is required. You must follow the dictates of your common sense. It would be fine if there were many great master teachers of acting, but there are not. Most acting teachers, unfortunately, are frauds, and they rely upon your complicity to survive. This not only deprives you of positive training, but stifles your greatest gift as an artist, your sense of truth. It is this sense of truth, a simplicity and feelings of wonder and reverence, all of which you possess, that will revitalize the theater. How do you translate them onto the stage? This book offers some wonderful, simple advice and suggestions. It's the best book written on acting in the last 20 years. The technical suggestions finally are reducible to a simple Stoic philosophy: be what you wish to seem. Stanislavski wrote you should play well or play badly, but play truly. It is not up to you to determine whether your performance will be brilliant. All that's under your control is your intention. It's not under your control whether your career will be brilliant. All that's under your control is your intention. If you intend to manipulate, to show, to impress, you may experience mild suffering and pleasant triumphs. If you intend to follow the truth you feel in yourself, to follow your common sense, and force your will to serve you, in the quest for discipline and simplicity, you will subject yourself to profound despair, loneliness, and constant self-doubt. And if you persevere, the theater which you are learning to serve will grace you now and then with the greatest exhilaration it's possible to know. This is David Mamet.
Author's note. This book originally evolved from an exercise assigned to us by David Mamet during his summer acting workshop in Montpelier, Vermont in 1984. The major portion of the text was gleaned from notes taken by the authors over several years in David's and W.H. Macy's acting classes, which were offered through New York University and at the Goodman Theater in Chicago. These acting classes resulted in the formation of the Atlantic Theater Company and Atlantic Acting School in New York. This approach to acting is now taught all over the world, and this acting book has been translated into many different languages, a testament to the power of this technique. The job of the actor. J.D. Salinger once said, "You were a reader before you were a writer." By the same token, all actors started out as audience members. What were the first things that struck us about the theatre? What are the things that draw us to the theatre again and again? What creates those moments that every audience member has had of sitting up in their chair because something has struck them in the gut? These moments are under no one person's control. Their creation is shared in equally by audience, actor, director, and technician. Realizing this, you, the actor, must understand that it is not rational to say, "It is my job to create these magical moments." Instead, you should realize that all you can do is bring yourself to the theatre in optimum condition to participate in the play at hand. Identifying what things you can do to put yourself in optimum condition, and then doing them consistently so that they become habitual, will give you the satisfaction of always knowing what to do, what your job truly is. The actor will find, however, that while their job may be clearly identifiable, it will not be easy. For example, to be in optimum condition to do a play, the actor must have a strong, clear, resonant voice. But developing this type of voice takes most people many years of training, of applying the will to working daily on effective vocal exercises. The actor must develop a body that will do whatever is asked of it, but this again requires the discipline to exercise, as well as the study of movement, so that the body will become as strong, supple, and graceful as the physical constraints with which they were born, and about which they can do nothing, will allow. The actor must look at themselves honestly, which requires a great deal of bravery, and use their common sense to determine what their own shortcomings are. Then the actor must determine which of these shortcomings it is within their control to change. Given this, the actor must devote themselves to doing everything they can to correct those things within their control, and must use their will to become to the fullest possible extent that person they would ideally like to be. Then when the actor comes to the theatre, they can have the satisfaction of saying to themselves, "I know exactly what my job is. I have done everything in my power to be ready to go on stage." This will free the actor to be more completely involved with the play as it unfolds on stage, because they will not be worrying about what they could have done to be more prepared. The best thing you can do for yourself as an actor is to clearly define and list those things that are your responsibilities and separate them from those things that are not. In other words, itemize what is within your control and what is not. If you apply this rather stoic philosophy of working on only those things within your control and not concerning yourself with those things that are not, then every moment you spend will be concretely contributing to your growth as an actor. Why not devote your time and energy to developing measurable skills such as your voice, your ability to analyze a script correctly, your ability to concentrate, and your body? On the other hand, how can it possibly help to concern yourself with the views others choose to take of you, the overall success or failure of the play, the ability or lack thereof of the director or other actors, which critics are sitting in the audience, your height, your feelings, and so forth? You cannot and never will be able to do anything about any of these things. Consequently, it makes sense to devote yourself only to those things which you have the capacity to change and refrain from wasting your time, thought, and energy on these things you can never affect. As an actor, you should never concern yourself with talent. Talent, if it exists at all, is completely out of your control. Whatever talent might be, you either have it or you don't, so why waste energy worrying about it? The only talent you need to act is a talent for working. In other words, the ability to apply yourself in learning the skills that make up the craft of acting. To put it simply, anyone can act if they have the will to do so, and anyone who says they want to but doesn't have the knack for it suffers from a lack of will, not a lack of talent. Another major part of the actor's job is to find a way to live truthfully under the imaginary circumstances of the play. Thus, the actor must be able to decide what is going on in the text in simple, actable terms. If the actor gives themselves something physically doable that they have a personal investment in for every scene, they will always have something more important to put their intention on than the success or failure of their own performance. Again, you, the actor, must use your common sense to identify what is and is not within your control. Your feelings are not within your control, so it is not within the bounds of common sense to say, I must feel this certain way for any particular moment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.